philology, you'll have to consider the formal structure and logic of the text. You want to consider the syntax and the voice. Look at the rhetoric and stylistics. And if possible, use some corpus comparison. And then with regard to perspective and effect, you want to consider possible author views, possible text-based views, and possible reader reactions, and try to configure some of this into your translation. Okay, things to look at include, what is the author's social historical background? What kind of details from this background can you incorporate into the text? In terms of text-based analysis, you want to try to identify the key elements and see how they fit together, how they relate to each other. And in terms of reader response, you want to consider historical versus modern readers, what are some of the differences, Eastern versus Western readers, how they would react differently, and perhaps the unique qualities or experiences of some special reader groups. Okay, now the first text that we're going to be, one more thing. Later on, as you start your translations, these are some of the requirements. First, I want you to produce multiple versions. I want you to produce at least two different translations. The last thing I want you to do is to just look at the text and write down the first thing that comes to mind and just give a surface rendition of the meaning of each word. That's not what we're aiming for. The purpose of this talk is to give you an idea of the multiple variables and options that are out there, and I want you to put these variables to use and try to produce more than one version. As you consider which options to use for particular issues, this should give you the variables that you need to produce these multiple versions. As you're translating, for the people that are coming up here to do it on the board, I want you to practice the think aloud protocol. Basically, talk about what's going through your head as you're considering word choice, as you're considering strategies for translation, so that we can understand what your thought process is. I want you to consider the merits and sacrifices made in each version. Whenever you go for one choice and not the other, you're always going to get something out of it, but also lose something. I want you to tell us what those things are. And one last thing. When you're explaining why you're going with a particular translation, the rule for most of my classes is don't mind reading. Okay, you can't say Confucius thinks, Confucius believes, Confucius feels, because you're not Confucius. You have no idea what's going through his head. All you could say is, based on this evidence, I think the most likely interpretation is this or that. Okay, is this clear? Does everybody understand what we're going to do? Okay, now this first text that I'm going to give you is a very popular one. I'm sure a lot of you have seen this before. This is Chapter 1, Section 1 of the Confucian Analects. Okay, so you have Yue Shi Xi Zhi, Hu Yi Yue Hu, Yu Feng Zi Yue Fang Lai, Hu Yi Le Hu, Ren Bu Zhi Er Hu Yin, Hu Yi Jun Zi Hu. How many of you have seen this before? Okay, and how many of you have never seen this before? Okay, for those of you that have never seen this text, skim through it quickly and tell me if there's something major that you don't understand. I want to make sure that everybody understands the general gist of it before we move ahead. Anything here that's unclear or difficult? No? Okay, for those of you that have seen it before, is there any element in here that you would like to understand better? Because reading for pleasure and reading for translation is pretty different. In reading for pleasure, you could just skip over stuff that you don't understand very well. But when you're reading for translation, you do have to know the meaning pretty well in order to produce a translation. So, you were... Okay?
For the yun and
ren bu zhi er gu yun. Okay. Ren bu zhi er gu yun. This would be a character that's not in use in modern Chinese, right? So it's natural that we can know the meaning of this. Using the methods that we used on Tuesday, you will probably look it up in the dictionary. If you do that, it'll give you the meaning of feeling displeasure. So not happy about it would be the meaning of it. Okay, anything else? Anything else people would like to understand better? Yeah? Okay, good. That is a very good question, actually. You know what? Let me get back to that in the end, okay? That's something I want to consider after discussing some of the easier questions. Anything else? If not, I have some questions for you. Before you start your translation, yeah. Okay. This and this, right? Take a wild guess. What is look?
I know they mean the same thing, right? But they mean the same thing, right? But mm-hmm. Why do they use different words?
Very good question. Well, tell me what you can get from these first, beginning with look. Your understanding of look comes from?
Happy.
Happy? Okay, in modern Chinese we have quite look. And then here we have a character that in modern Chinese would be shuo, which is to speak, right? But when I was reading it, I pronounced it yue. Why is that? Why isn't it 不易说乎? Nobody has an issue with this.
Well, it's a variant reading. It's a different word. It's not shuo, it's not shui.
How do you know it's not shuo, it's not shui?
Because that's what my teacher told me.
First, when you put it in this context, because it's written as shuo, you would probably have to begin by considering shuo or shi. But as you do that, you will begin to see that it doesn't make a lot of sense in this context. And to solve this problem, we have to use another little trick in classical Chinese. We used one on Tuesday, which was word class conversion, and that allowed us to solve one problem. Today we need to solve another. And that is that in Confucius' time, characters were not as standardized as they are now. So very often people would use one character that sounds the same or sounds similar to another character to replace that character. So if that is the case, the question we want to ask here is, which character is shuo replacing? And you might begin by asking, what character sounds like shuo? Is there any other character that sounds like shuo? Not in modern Chinese. In modern Chinese, you might say, okay, maybe shuo sounds like shuo. But shuo would not make any sense here either, right? Okay, and the issue here is that when you're asking what character sounds like shuo, we cannot use modern Mandarin to answer this question, but we need to use the language of the time. And this is where historical philology and rhyme books come in. There are two ways we can do this. We can look at the design of the character, and we can use rhyme books to trace the historical pronunciation of the character. Now, what we pronounce as shuo or shui in modern Chinese, we can get a better idea of what it sounded like back then if we refer to some of the more conservative southern dialects. Do we have any Taiwanese or Cantonese speakers here? Okay, you speak Cantonese, okay? How would you pronounce this in Cantonese? This character?
Shui,
okay? So something like this, right? Oh, this is in the IPA, so. This is a sh sound, this is e, this is u, this is tuk, so shi. So, a few things are different. First, we know that this character has a ta ending, and the beginning is different. It's a sh rather than a sh. Now, historically, about 1,000 years ago, this character would have been pronounced something like shuo. And if we go even further back, this sh sound would have been voiced, so it would have been pronounced something like zhuo. Now, as this character evolved, it evolved in two directions, as this zh initial disappeared in Old Chinese. In one direction, the zh lost its voicing and became sh. In another direction, this zh was deleted altogether, and it became yue. Okay, so in Confucius' time, this character would have been Zhuo, But later, there were two pronunciations, short and yot. This short became what we now pronounce as short. This yot became what we now say as yue. Okay, so to say we have yue, we have short, which look very different when in fact they have a common source. Okay, now you also notice that the short has this component here, which is similar to this component that you find over here. And the reason for it is because they used to have a similar pronunciation, but they kind of split off in different directions. Which is why, if we take this character to be pronounced this way, then it makes sense that the person writing this may actually be referring to this meaning and not this meaning. Okay, does that make sense? Yeah.
Why do we have yue at the beginning written in one variant and then shuo or yue written in the other?
Oh, okay. In the analects, I believe they're using the yue as a verb of saying, to say.
Yeah.
Whereas this, what looks like shuo to us, actually means joyful. Yeah. It doesn't mean to speak, it means it's.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so that kind of solves this problem, right? But that didn't answer your question, which is what is the difference between yue, if we were to interpret this as this one? What's the difference between yue and le? Okay, let's fall back on modern Chinese a little bit. What words do you find yue in? What are some expressions that have yue?
Xi
yue. Okay? And expressions that have le?
Huan le.
Huan le, quite le. What's the difference between xi yue and huan le? Are they the same or are they different?
Xi yue seems to be more inside.
Xi yue is more inside?
Huan le is outside.
Okay, is quite le also outside?
Yes.
Okay, so there might be, let's see. But I can also say, well, nei xin quite le. Can I say that?
But you have to specifically qualify that's internal. That means quite le itself is not.
Quite le itself is not?
Because you have to say nei xin quite le, right?
I could also say nei xin de xi yue.
That's true.
Or let's look at it this way. In terms of intensity, is one stronger than the other?
Xi yue.
Xi yue is stronger?
So.
How is that so?
I don't know. Something is just very deep inside.
Uh-huh. Let's say you have two situations. Okay. One is that I'm driving here from San Francisco. I know it's usually hot here. I hope it won't get too hot. And what's the temperature now? Let's say it's 75, which is bearable. Okay, so I'm pleased with that. That's one situation. The other is that, let's say I bought a lottery ticket. I hope I'll win, and I won $1 million. Okay, so we would agree that 75 degree temperature would be different from winning a big lottery. Which one would you use UF for? Which one would you use for? Okay.
And it was
quite a lot, right? Quite a lot. Okay. Quite a lot for the lottery, yeah. Yeah, quite a lot for the lottery, for sure. Okay. So we do need to make a distinction here, and I'll tell you why later. One possibility is that there's a different level of intensity. One is stronger than the other. The other may be that one is internal, the other is external. We're going to explore these possibilities later. These are some of the variables that we can consider. Okay, any other questions regarding the words, expressions here that you would like to disambiguate before we move further? Okay, if not, let's look at structure. After ziyue, the expression, basically what Confucius says, how many sections would you divide it into? Three, okay. What's part one?
First question mark.
Okay, this would be number one. The second one would be 有朋自远方来,无依乐乎, that would be number two, right? Number three would be 人不知而不愠,无依君子乎. Okay, a few questions about the three parts, and this is where we'll take a structuralist perspective. Are the three parts symmetrical or partly symmetrical?
Yes.
Okay, how so?
They all have two statements.
They all have two statements, good.
And the first, and then they all have good.
Okay, the second half basically changes it into a question. It's all we something who. So they're symmetrical in a sense, right? So you'll have to consider, when you translate it into English, do you want to make it symmetrical like this? Do you want to make your translation have two parts for each question? And do you want to make the second half of the question symmetrical? Next, what's the relationship between part one, part two, and part three? Is there a relationship? Usually when you analyze a literary text, you would assume that what appears is not randomly structured. So we're going to assume that Confucius didn't make three random comments like, my computer is nice, look at the sun, it's bright, this floor is made of plastic. They're not random. If they're not random, then there's got to be a relationship. What's the relationship? They're all talking about feeling, but if we go with talking about feeling, we could have a million things that are wrong. Feelings. I guess what I would like to
general
see is...
They go from general to specific. Sort of a general situation.
Which is the most general situation?
Well, the first one isn't study, a joyful thing.
Okay.
And then gets a little bit more specific. To have someone come from far away.
Let me stop you there for a minute. Is someone coming from far away a kind of study?
No, but within the context of study, maybe that's what I'm carrying over on that.
Explain that for me a little more.
So if your mind is put into the frame of study, and then this idea of having someone come from a distance, you're automatically thinking that study is a topic rather than, say, tea or
how
long you build a house.
So in order to create that transition to make it related, you want to assume that this person coming from far away isn't coming just for dinner or a basketball game or something. It's related to study. Now what about this third part? How does it relate to the second part?
It's a finer analysis of the process of learning. So if I get this correctly, I don't know. If one does not engage in this study, if one does not know, then they're not happy. And then how much more so is that the case for a junior?
What does that have to do with the friend coming from far?
Not a whole lot, except that the, we have to start interpreting things on our own, that somehow it's building the environment of study of having a friend come.
Okay.
And if you're, if you don't have that environment of study, you're not going to be happy, especially if you're a scholar.
You're headed in the right direction, but, I think we'll have to understand these individual characters a little bit deeper in order to build that link for us. Yeah.
Oh, so what you were talking about, the difference between Yue and love, this made me think that all of it is related to your happiness. And
okay.
The first one is like about studying, so like you have a little bit of happiness, and the second one is this friend, so you're a little more happy about that. The third one, I assume, is we're supposed to be very happy.
Okay, that's very good. There are stronger links and there are weaker links. We began with the assumption that maybe all of these are about feelings. So you have an umbrella term, which is feeling, and then what falls under it is three types of feelings. That's okay, but that's not the best thing. What we had later from you and you is that between one, two, and three, they're all under the same umbrella, but one leads to two leads to three. That would make for a stronger link, and that is where we want to go with it. We had something in the back? Yeah.
I was just thinking, if people don't know you, then they won't come to visit you.
Okay, if people don't know you.
So if a junta is, totally fine with people not knowing probably enjoy studying more than people do.
Okay. That will kind of make number two the little pivot in the middle, right? They come to see because of study, and then this is, they have to know you if they want to visit you. Okay, that's a possibility. Yeah?
I think it's, my understanding of this is the, it's kind of like a path, kind of like a path of dreams of practicing. Mm-hmm. So in the beginning, you learn and you practice it, and then you have people that share the same aspiration. Mm-hmm. So that's very joyous, joyful. Mm-hmm. And then as your practice goes deeper as being a Jinzu, mm-hmm. then it gets to, oh, even people don't know, because you're a Jinzu, you don't get upset.
Yeah, so it's more like that makes it related to number one or number two?
It's like a level one of practicing, level okay. two of practicing, and level three of practicing.
Why is level three higher than level two?
Because level three is, I think it's more, when you have friends that that share the same thing, mm-hmm. that affirms your...
That's number two, right?
Yeah, that's number two.
Okay.
Yeah, that affirms what you're doing is great. Mm-hmm. So it's really good. And then the third one is to get rid of the ego. That's really difficult.
Okay.
So the third one is higher level of practice.
Okay, that's really good. That kind of gives it a Buddhist flavor, right? Yeah, I like that. Yeah?
I was thinking of the possibility of that structure is actually circular.
Mm-hmm.
So the first one starts out with it is pleasurable to do learning.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And then the link to the second part is it's pleasurable to have friends come and visit. And then the third part is a specific friend, perhaps. This person, mm-hmm. isn't he great? And he's not discomposed by all these things. And then that part links back to the first one.
Wait, tell me about the third part again. What's the third part?
I'm looking specifically at the translation here.
Okay.
So but thinking that perhaps the man who's mm-hmm. coming in the third part mm-hmm. is the friend in
yes.
the second part.
Okay.
And then you have the character of this man, right, who, and that character I think is informed
mm-hmm.
by this kind of education.
Okay.
Right? So the third part actually connects back to the first part, right?
Okay.
It's like this guy, this friend who's coming to visit has all of these great qualities.
This is
delightful.
The friend has all these qualities?
Has these good qualities. I mean, in this translation it says, is he not a man of complete virtue who feels no discomposure and then takes no note of him?
Now, how does that relate to Rinpoche or Bui? The friend has a good quality.
I'm not good enough to be able to do that, sorry.
Okay. I think if I were to go with your line of reasoning, correct me if I'm wrong, I'm studying all this stuff and it feels great. I have a friend coming to visit, and having a friend come visit is great too. And the friend doesn't know I'm so good at studying this stuff, but I'm okay with that. Something like that?
No, the friend himself is great in what he's accomplished.
Okay. That's where it doesn't quite square up with the text.
Okay.
The Rinpoche, I can't see how it can refer to the friend. Mm-hmm. Yeah?
Maybe the vision of all these is because all humans human qualities
okay.
that make human beings mm-hmm. more valuable than just not doing these.
But then again, you're putting it under an umbrella, but I would like to see one leading to the other, forming a chain that would make a stronger link. Yeah. Now, we might be able to get more answers if we look at some of these characters specifically. Let's start with part one. 学而时习之,不亦说乎? Okay. The two verbs here are the 学 and the 习, right? Are they the same? Are they different? What do they mean? Okay.
习 means to learn practice.
Okay. And 学?
To learn, like study.
Is 学 to learn or to study? In your translation, would you prefer learn or would you prefer study? What's
learn.
The difference between
learn.
Them? Learn. Okay, why is that? What's the difference between learn and study?
You can study, but you might not learn
anything. Study is the act of poring over your both for doing whatever your assignment is, and you may come away thinking, that's the fish stuff.
Okay, so study refers to effort. Learning includes the actual result of getting something out of it. That's one difference. Anything else? I can learn how to change a spare tire, right? Can I study it? I can learn how to change a light bulb. Can I study how to change a light bulb?
Yeah.
But the meaning will be quite different. Right? Study is more in an academic context, whereas the scope of learning is much broader can include very trivial things. Okay, so these are some of the things to consider when you're choosing between learning and studying, and there are people who use both of these. Now, xi over here, somebody said, was what?
Two.
Okay, there are at least three possible interpretations here. Even with the English word practice, there are different types of practice. Practice can mean to do something over and over again so that I get better at it. If I get a musical score, I can practice on the piano so that maybe a week later I can perform it. So practice just means repeating over and over. That's one type of practice, right? Another type of practice is if I learn something in theory and I have a chance to actually use it. This is not necessarily doing it over and over again. It's just putting it into application. This would be practice too, right? Let's say, what's a good example? Okay, I learn about the linguistic theory of language development, and then suddenly I have a little baby, so I could use my theory to understand what the baby is trying to say. That will be putting this theory into practice. That's a very different type of practice from doing something repetitively, right? So that's another one. And what's the third one?
Review.
Review, okay. So like when you learn something, you forget it, and you go back and review it, that would be another type. So you want to decide which kind of xi it is. What is the shi here? What is the shi? Shi er shi xi zhi, what does the shi mean? Constantly?
From time to time,
yeah.
Okay, from time to time. Okay, these two are different, right? From time to time is not very intensive. Constantly is more intensive. Any other interpretation?
Always. Maybe when the opportunity comes.
When the opportunity comes, at the right time.
At the right
okay.
time.
Okay. This kind of goes with putting something into practice. I've learned the theory, and once I get the opportunity, I use it. Okay. So again, you would have to decide what that shi means. So with these three variables, that should give you plenty of combinations. Okay, 胡一月胡, we kind of agreed that yue has something to do with happiness. What is the who?
Interrogative particle,
question particle. Okay, so what does 不亦乐乎 mean?
Isn't it pleasant?
Isn't it pleasant, okay. What does isn't it pleasant mean?
Is it pleasant?
Does isn't it pleasant mean the same thing as is it pleasant?
No.
No? Okay. Very good. Okay, does everybody understand that?
Yeah.
Is it pleasant is a neutral question. Maybe you can answer it is pleasant, maybe you can answer it isn't pleasant. Whereas when I say isn't it pleasant, it implies that I do think it's pleasant. And I want you to tell me whether you agree with me or not. Okay, so from here, we know that Confucius does believe, or whoever is saying this, does believe that it is pleasant and it is seeking confirmation. What does the yi do here? 不亦乎 is isn't it pleasant, right? What about the 不亦乎?
For its part.
For its part.
Yeah, it's not the case. Yeah, I don't know exactly. No. Is this thing, this aforementioned thing, not pleasant?
Is this aforementioned thing not pleasant? How is that different from is it not pleasant?
Okay.
This, I think, is one of the hardest parts. I myself don't have a good answer for it, but later on we'll look at some translations that try to deal with this. A lot of people simply ignore this, and some people do translate it as something. We'll see how they fare. Okay, so that's the first part. Second part, 有朋自远方来不亦乐乎. Let's look at the 朋. What does 朋 mean? In modern Chinese, we talk about 朋友. So we think 朋 is it. So that would be a friend, right? If you look up the etymology of the character, you will actually see that 朋 is two of these things, one next to the other. So instead of a friend who you're friendly with, it's more like a peer, somebody you're doing the same thing with, somebody you're learning with. And in that context, it relates this to the 学. Here I'm trying to study or learn, and then here I have somebody coming up from afar who is learning with me, or who also likes the stuff that I learned, and that creates a relation. Okay, and that brings us to part three, 人不知 or 不运. You will want to ask, 不知 what? And the logical answer would be 不知 whatever we are 学. Okay, so this relates this to this part. It's kind of like, you could kind of say, let's say you're really interested in Star Wars, so I'm studying all kinds of Star Wars stuff, and then the Star Wars fan club from England comes to my house, and we're all poring over the Star Wars stuff, and we're really happy. And other people don't care about Star Wars, but it doesn't matter to us. They don't like it, that's their business, we like it. When you get into this state of mind, then that is really a kind of level. Something like that would bring it all together. Okay, so any other questions so far? So far we've basically divided this text into three parts. We wanted to create some links between the three parts, and we did that through an understanding of symmetry, through an understanding of how number one leads to number two leads to number three, and there are options throughout. So I'm sure everybody can come up with a slightly different translation, and you should have no trouble producing two different versions. Now, who would like to come up here and write your translation on the board?
How many?
I need three.
Three
and a half. Huh? Oh. Or two is fine, two or three. Maybe one person can take this board, one person can take the left half of this board, somebody can take the right half. Anybody? You look like you might be interested. You want to be better? Yeah, you and me. Oh, all three of you can come.
Yay.
Okay, let me turn this off. Oh, you don't have the source text, huh? Okay, that's a problem. Oops.
I think I can refer to your laptop, if that's okay.
Oh, okay. Or you know what? Let me put this back on. Why don't you guys take this board over here? And the third person, if you like, just write underneath the source text. Okay, this will be on in a minute.
Okay, the Chinese.
I
Yeah. Do you want to go around and use my little corner there? Okay.
Continue.
Okay.
Continue.
Oh, okay. So maybe you can just go
there.
Yeah. Or you don't come back. You guys are doing good work and doing it really fast too. Let's begin with this translation here. What is your name?
James.
James, can you walk us through your thinking? What went through your mind when you were producing this?
Okay, so
the very first thing I did when you put that quote up was look it up online because my classical training is terrible. That was my very first thought.
Okay.
I was thinking, I hope he doesn't call on me. I better be right. and then I quickly used an electronic dictionary to look up the characters and found out that a lot of what my dictionary was saying was wrong while you're talking. So I was just trying to listen to what other people were saying. Isn't it pleasant also matched the text that I was looking at? There was an English translation there. So I thought, well, that sounds good. To constantly study and apply yourself, I hear constantly from something that someone else had said. And I was thinking study or learn. You know, it sounded like maybe learning was more what the line had been saying, based on applying yourself, habits, practices, things that people had said about practices. But I thought, well, maybe that's already in this second character, which I have to go check the pronunciation. It still might not be right. Maybe it says in addition the practice. So I thought, well, maybe these ideas can sort of balance each other. And I decided to go with study, and then sort of emphasize the application of the second character.
Okay.
Study and apply yourself. Yeah, you know, sort of makes sense. And then I just used the same arrangement of ideas in the second line. So the same form, isn't it blank to blank? And again, the translation that I was already looking at said pleasant and delight. And that seemed to sort of fit with the idea that there's a feeling and then sort of a fun something outside. Not really, I don't feel very confident about that, but it's to write something. I wrote that down. And then I just wrote come or friends. I'm used to seeing Mario, so. Friend, Antonio is friend, okay. Bye is come, and then I guess that last expression that ends with bomb. Maybe it's again bomb, that's what it says in my dictionary, but I didn't really recognize the way of pronouncing it, it's far away. And then I kept the same beginning, just to sort of keep the parallelism. Trinza, I just said virtuous. Person, kind of arbitrary. I like the idea of a virtuous person being the end, so I decided to use a positive expression or something like that. And then the last part I'm not really that satisfied with, I just sort of something else. I'm also used to hearing Chandra Shirk a lot, because it's sort of a Buddhist expression, someone who knows you, friend who recognizes you. And again, from my, I think it was my first semester of Chinese, we learned that Renshir is recognized. It's like, okay, that's sort of, that's what the word that popped into my head, and I thought, well, that could sort of be about social recognition too, so maybe that's an implication here.
You did a lot of good things here. Let's take a brief look. Okay, first you created a good parallelism between all three, isn't it? Okay, this is parallel, which mirrors what you have in the source text. And then the rhythm is also pretty similar. So you don't have sentences that are too long here with ones that are too short. They're roughly about the same length, which is good. There are a few things that I wanted to ask you about. I want to see whether it's it's okay, just leave it there. Yeah. Now, the last line. Isn't a virtuous person content, even when people don't recognize him? Whereas the original was the other way around, right? let's see, what is it? Isn't it a virtuous person who is content? What you told me, don't break it. So the content was moved from here to here. Was that intentional?
No. Actually, that's one of the reasons why I'm not particularly happy with that.
Okay. So that's something that it reads well, but it's a little bit different from the original. And then to have friends come from afar. So then these friends are not necessarily related to the constantly studying. These would be things that I would be asking about. There was one thing I forgot to mention before I let you guys go into this. Let's go back to the source text again. 学而时习之, that er, what does the er mean? Anybody?
Condition.
Hmm?
It sets up a condition which one is doing the practicing. Practice under the condition of having studied. To study and then practice.
So the it separates the condition from what happens under that condition.
Yes.
Okay? Is that what everybody else understood the er to be? I'm asking this because you can see from these translations that different people treated the er differently. Who wrote this one? This one over here, the one in the blue.
The top left.
Hmm?
The top left.
The top left.
Yeah.
That is yours? Okay, what's your name?
Alejandro.
Sorry?
Alejandro.
Alejandro?
Yeah.
Okay. Alejandro treated it as a condition. He used when. When you put into practice what you have learned. Okay, that's a conditional. Whereas James used an and, constantly study and apply yourself. When you have an and like this, you have two sequential events. Now, English and includes a lot of different meanings. It could be two parallel things, like projector and computer. If it's two parallel things, I can switch it around. Computer and projector and computer, same thing. Whereas when it's sequential actions, constantly study and apply yourself, you can't really switch it around. You can't say apply yourself and constantly study. The sequence is different. Okay, so getting back to my main point, which is that you could treat the and differently. You could treat the er differently. Now, Alejandro, why don't you walk us through your translation and maybe also talk a little bit about why you use the when structure.
I'm just thinking of something different what I'm comfortable with, so kind of hit it up a little complicated. So basically, I try to copy the Chinese thought structure.
Mm-hmm.
So kind of like, when you do this and this, then aren't you this, aren't you that?
Okay.
So that's basically how I try to translate it.
Mm-hmm. Anything else you want to talk about? Or why don't you read through it first and then talk about it?
Reality.
Hmm? Or if you want, you can come to the front and read it.
Sure. Yes. I can see it. Okay, so when you put into practice what you have learned, are you not pleased? When friends come from afar, are you not happy? When others don't recognize you, yet you don't get angry, are you not a gentleman?
Okay. Anything else you want to say about it?
Jingzi, I've seen many different translations of it.
Okay.
And I just tried gentleman this time.
Okay. Good. And we'll discuss that in a minute. Okay, first let's look at the first line of James's translation and Alejandro's translation. James's translation reads, isn't it pleasant to constantly study and apply yourself? Alejandro, when you put into practice what you have learned, are you not pleased? Pros and cons. Anybody want to discuss this?
Are you not pleased?
Mm-hmm.
Sort of is addressing someone directly.
Okay.
And I think that might be lacking in the original text.
Okay. And that's a good point. We can also compare that with this purple group. Who wrote this one? Okay, what's your name?
Lotus.
Okay. Lotus wrote, is it not pleasant to learn and put one has put what one has learned into practice from time to time. Okay, so Lotus has one to put what one has learned into practice. Alejandro has, are you not pleased? And then James has, to constantly study and apply yourself. In terms of voice, how is the voice of these three different? Let's start with the Alejandro's. Are you not pleased? Are you speaking to anybody? It sounds like you are. And are you not pleased kind of means you should be pleased. Don't you? Right? Okay. What about James's? Isn't it pleasant to constantly study and apply yourself? Is it addressed at anybody in particular? Yes. It could be or it could not be. The you could be an abstract. What about Lotus's quote, what one has learned? Is it addressing anybody in particular? No, it's kind of like speaking to me, abstract. So there is a difference in this respect. Junzi, okay. Junzi is often translated as gentleman. Some people like it, some people don't like it. What are the pros and cons of using gentleman for Junzi?
Too general.
Hmm?
Too gentle.
How so? Tell me the difference between a virtuous gentleman and a noble gentleman.
A gentleman
just
has more qualities. Just a gentleman.
What's just a gentleman?
One who is a gentleman compared to one who is not a gentleman.
What is a gentleman?
That's why it's too general.
We have to know what it means, though, to say it's too general, then we can start narrowing it down.
Upright.
Hmm?
Upright, a gentleman is upright.
Somebody who is upright is a gentleman. We have a hand in the back.
A gentleman is too, it's not strong enough.
Okay.
It's too ordinary. Okay. I open the door for you, automatically, everything that you just talked about, it's not really like that. It's like, also, woman can be twinsy, so. That is like half the translation.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What about Trinzi? What is Trinzi supposed to refer to?
An ideal that we can also represent. And it's
an ideal in what way?
It's written at the stage level.
What?
Like in terms of the way you think and behave, and the way you carry yourself. And the way people talk about you.
Okay, so somebody who has good behavior, differently. Okay. And isn't that very general?
Son of a prince.
Hmm?
Son of a ruler. A lordling.
That could also be a trinzi, but a different kind of trinzi. Okay, but getting back to this. Let's see, where were we?
Yeah. A gentleman is more like a person who's gentle, who's courteous.
Uh-huh.
So a lot of, from outside, he looks very, you know, behavior is very mannered.
Mm-hmm.
But Junzi is more internal, describing a person's intrinsic nature, just virtue.
Okay. Yeah. So from this perspective, a virtuous person would match Trinzi is better than gentleman, is it?
I think as gentlemen, we have to recognize the class consciousness in the word as well.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
yes.
It's coming from an English society point of view.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Just because you're male and wear clean clothes doesn't mean you're a gentleman.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a very class distinction there.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
It also has a specific place and time. You could also say it's a little bit dated in our age. Okay? Yeah?
I have the different interpretation of the Jin.
Okay?
Because the first two, the Yue and the Le is an adjective.
Mm-hmm.
And the Jin, I think, should be an adjective as well, instead of being a dog. So in the Jin, I sort of like to translate it as a noble act.
A what?
A noble act.
A noble egg?
Act.
A noble act, okay. Okay.
To describe something instead of being a person.
Okay. Now let me see if I understand you correctly. So far, people here have been treating Junzi as an entity, as a person. Whereas you're saying the Junzi here should be an adjective. You're saying that it's a Junzi-like behavior, so you want to say that this is a noble act. Okay, that's a very interesting perspective. And yeah.
I'm wondering if a friend could appear, as you brought up, so that you're here and you're studying and somebody comes to study with you, and that Junzi could apply to both of you, so that the last one would be, here we are in our study. Mm-hmm. Isn't it the trait of a virtuous person not to show displeasure when he's not understood? We're studying together. I was studying alone when I was happy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you came.
Yes.
And then we may not agree, but won't we both be gentlemen?
Oh, you're saying that there is a disagreement between the two.
I'm saying that potentially there could be, but since we're gentlemen, we won't do that.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I like that. And I like the fact that you put the since we're here or here we are, that creates a link with what we have in number two. That's kind of nice too. Okay, so let's move on a little bit. We talked about Alejandro's. Who wrote the one over here? Okay, what's your name?
Miguel.
Okay, Miguel, you want to come to the front and read yours?
Read it from here.
Okay, read it from here.
Okay, so, isn't it helpful to constantly review what you learn? Isn't it pleasing when a friend visits from far away? When one isn't understood by others, yet... it should be one. Yeah, one doesn't get angry. Isn't one a virtuous person?
Okay. So we've looked at two translations so far. How does yours compare with theirs? What are the pros or the cons of your religion?
Instead of put into practice, I have reviewed.
Okay, you have reviewed. Instead of apply. Or what do we have here? To put into practice. So you have a very different interpretation of the xi.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Tell us why you want to use review.
Well, that's how I learned it in Chinese.
Which one do you think makes better sense?
I think you said Chinese class. Mm-hmm. Aren't you attending
Chinese
class?
Mm-hmm. No. That's okay. So. That's what I learned in Chinese. And then, I use you and one.
Okay.
That might be a problem, but I think you, for the second one, if you use you, then it sounds a little too much like you're talking right towards somebody.
In the second,
when I use when one isn't understood.
Okay, that's the third one.
Yeah, the third one.
Yeah.
If I say if you aren't understood, it sounds to me maybe like you're talking to someone, right? Yeah. It's directly talking to someone.
Mm-hmm.
For the first one, it sounds a little more general.
Okay. With this sort of translation, we tend not to give more than one choice. So we tend not to have he/she, or to have something in parentheses. So I would recommend that you choose one over the other. Some people may say that using he is a little sexist, but I would say if you have to choose one, then you probably have to go with the he. And,
question
yeah.
For the during translation, we come to the same issue basically.
Yes.
And then somebody suggested that we can use they. So he, one isn't understood by others, yet they don't get angry. Is that like a common practice?
Okay, there are probably three options here. They each have their strengths and weaknesses. You could use one, but one makes it very abstract simply. One makes it look like you're talking to the air. You're not talking to anybody, and it's less personal. You could use you or you could use he over here, but then the he gives it a certain gender that some people may not like. Now, you could use they, which is a fairly modern thing, but because it's a fairly modern thing, it makes it more colloquial. Some people would say that it's not traditional grammar that uses gender-neutral they. So they each have a small problem, and you have to see which is the lesser meaning, basically. Yeah?
So based on what you said about the pattern, I put in kindred friends. Isn't it happening to have kindred friends visiting from afar? And then I use the word happening as kindred to know that it's one who knows from the same part to the other.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and that creates a connection. That's good. Okay, so we're going to go to Lotus's version. Do you want to read yours?
Okay, is it not pleasant to learn and put what and to learn and put what one has learned into practice at the time?
Mm-hmm.
Is it not joyful to have one's peers come from afar?
Okay.
Is it not becoming of a noble person to not be upset even when others do not recognize?
Okay. Now the first thing I want to point out is Lotus is the only one who has translated the Shi from time to time. Oh, actually, no, that's not true. James also has the constantly. And Alejandro and... Sorry, it's just that Alejandro. Alejandro, you drop the shoe, right? When you put into practice what you have learned.
I wasn't sure if I put that in.
Okay. Now, Lotus, you have that from time to time, but that makes it quite a bit longer. So number one becomes quite a bit longer than number two. Did that disturb you?
Kind of, now that you bring it up.
Okay. If you have more time, what would you do?
I'd probably use a different expression from time to time, maybe like one or two words. Shrink it down a little to keep it like more consistent.
You can make number one shorter, or you could add something to number two to make it longer. Okay, and for Jinzi, you have noble person.
Yeah.
Tell us about it.
Well, because I was talking about it with her, or we were like discussing it, and she talked about how she also heard gentleman, but like gentleman is may not be like the best term. So like I thought like a noble, although noble person can be read in different ways, I guess.
Okay.
So like
tell
I guess,
us about the different ways.
So for this part, you could read it as like a noble person as in they've been born into nobility, but you could also read it as they have noble conduct, as in they're righteous and etc. So.
Okay.
I guess in this case, of course, I meant with noble conduct.
Mm-hmm.
Although
okay.
I'm not altogether happy with noble person either.
Okay. Now here we ran into a situation where certain terms in the target language may have more than one meaning. Okay. Sometimes both of the meanings are there. Sometimes we have one predominant meaning, but there's another meaning lurking in the background. Sometimes you want that. Sometimes you don't. An example of that would be the word recognize that we had in James's translation and also in Lotus's translation. Even when people don't recognize him, recognize can be, you talked to me yesterday, I still recognize you. That's one kind of recognize. The other kind of recognize is I'm famous for the work that I do and it is accepted or recognized by others. Okay, in this translation, both meanings of recognize work. And you could kind of argue that the Renpoche in Chinese could also be read both ways. So having these two meanings in English recognized is good. Now, on your use of noble, you mentioned rightly that there are two meanings of noble. It could be somebody that is born into aristocracy. It could also be somebody whose conduct is noble. Do we want both of these? Or would you prefer to just have the one?
Probably the one, because you can be born into
okay. It might not necessarily be a bad thing because of, what's your name?
Tony.
Okay. Tony was mentioning just now that the Jun can be an emperor, right? The Jun, interpreted separately, could be the son of an emperor. In that case, it also has the ring of aristocracy. So taking this into consideration, I would say that your choice of noble isn't necessarily that bad there. Okay. Am I missing anything? Is there anybody else who wants to share their translation? Read it out loud, or do you have something different? Yeah, go for it.
To study and apply one's knowledge at the opportune time, is that not joyous? To have a companion who arrives from afar, Is that not joyous? To have no renown yet not be dissatisfied. Is that not sainthood?
Okay. Everybody got that, right? Let me ask you two things. First, I think yours is the one that preserved, yours is the only one that preserved the Chinese word order. You started with to do this and that, is it not joyous? Okay, whereas the other people switched it around. Isn't it pleasant to do this and that? Okay, what are the pros and cons of keeping the Chinese word order versus switching it around? Yeah?
Helps you learn Chinese if you're gonna compare them.
Okay. If your purpose is to learn Chinese. But a lot of people would argue that when you translate something like this, the purpose isn't necessarily for people who want to read the Chinese and English next to each other.
It's a little more oratory, mm-hmm. or kind of, you know, poetic or something. Mm-hmm. This is more, these options are more fluid and sort of mm-hmm. a usual usage, whereas this kind of sounds more like a grand statement.
Okay, that's a good point. This is something that you would say to someone. Isn't it pleasant to do this? Whereas to do this is not pleasant. It sounds more formal. It sounds like you're giving a lecture, and that's the effect you want to communicate. Did I hear you right in that you use joyous for both one and two? Okay, why the repetition?
Because, so I like the fact that it's one clause, so mm-hmm. forth, and yes. then I think that I also translated Junza as an adjective, and mm-hmm. I think that maybe there's a message about joyous sagely. Mm-hmm. So like, you know, the repetition, you have joyous in your head and then you see sagely, and it's sort of showing that actually Junza has something joyful about it.
Okay. Some people would say that you're conflating two terms, the yue.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Run.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. All right. Anybody else? Okay, so I think we did good work here with this first translation. As you were doing your translation, did you run?
Question.
Oh, okay.
I just like when I asked I put the positive take on the mm-hmm. so.
Give me the whole sentence. The third one.
Confucius said, "Isn't it gratifying to constantly put into practice what one has learned? Isn't it heartening to have kindred friends visiting from afar? Isn't one a virtuous gentleman who remains serene when unrecognized by others?"
Okay, so for the Wuyun, he used a positive adjective rather than a negation of something that is negative. And you felt that was better to pass.
I don't know. I don't view it as better. I just, it's a personal choice.
Okay, did people like it? Okay, I think it's fine. Okay, before we move on, any other comments? Any problems you ran into that you want to share with people? Okay, if not, we're going to move on to the next translation. We don't have a lot of time for it, but let's get three other people up here. Any volunteers? Let's say three. Another hand. Let me give you the text first.
Volunteer?
Oh, I forgot to do this.
You know what? Hmm?
Oh, sorry. I forgot we were going to look at other translations too. Maybe we'll just do that then. Sorry, Game Ship, when do we, how much more time do we have? When we
have up to
14. Okay. Let's look at some published translations. Okay, let's begin with D.C. Lao. The master said, "Is it not a pleasure, having learned something, to try it out at due intervals? Is it not a joy to have friends come from afar? Is it not gentlemanly not to take offense when others fail to appreciate your abilities?" Okay, how is this different from what you produced? And do you like it? Do you not like it? James.
Appreciate your abilities. Mm-hmm. Seems like a lot of information.
Okay. So for the Fu Zhi, DC Lao interprets the Fu Zhi as relating to your abilities rather than any other aspects that you should be recognized for. It becomes more specific here. Right? In terms of rhythm, number one is much longer than number two. Number three is longer. You'll notice that the Shi is interpreted as at due intervals, which is different from some other reasons. And then the Jizi is interpreted as an adjective, like somebody mentioned over here. Is it not gentlemanly? Although your criticisms of gentlemen could also apply to this. Any other comments? Okay, let's move on to the next one. Sign in the lead. The master said, to learn something and then put it into practice at the right time, is this not a joy? To have friends coming from afar, is this not a delight? Not to be upset when one's merits are ignored, is this not the mark of a gentleman? Okay, pros, cons? Yeah.
I feel like the last part, not to be upset and not to be ignored, is similar to the previous one.
Mm-hmm. Now, the previous one talks about abilities, right?
Yeah.
Whereas this one talks about merits.
Yeah.
There is some overlap, but you could also say that there are some differences.
When I see if people don't know you, I kind of left it very broad.
You left the base,
like when you mentioned, like two meanings possible.
Yes. He would prefer to have both of these meetings present.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Good. Okay. So this. Let's see. Where did it go? Okay. The next one. Brooks and Brooks. The master said, "To learn and in due time rehearse it. Is this not also pleasurable? To have friends coming from far places. Is this not also delightful? If others do not recognize him, but he is not disheartened, is he not also a gentleman?" What's different here?
The also.
The also, okay. How does that also sound to you?
Because like, usually when you say also, you're like comparing to something you've already said, so I'm not sure what he's comparing it to.
Mm-hmm.
That's a little
off-putting. Okay, that's good. He's trying to translate the yi. Yi in classical Chinese is like modern Chinese yi. And then he is equal to also, so he puts the also in here. But when you have an also in a sentence, like you said, it assumes that I already told you something earlier, and that this also is comparing it to what I mentioned earlier. Does everybody get what I'm saying? Okay, so this is what makes it a little odd. If others do not recognize him, but he is not disheartened, is he not also a gentleman? He kind of switches to the third person, which is also a little bit different from but most of the other translations. Yeah. Right. Okay, also, xi, the interpretation of xi is different, right?
Mm-hmm.
Here he's using rehearse, which is to practice repetitively. Okay, David Henson. To learn and then in due season, put what you have learned into practice. Isn't that still a great pleasure? And to have a friend visit from somewhere far away, isn't that still a great joy? When you're ignored by the world like this, and yet bear not resentment, isn't that great nobility? Okay, so you have the use of the word nobility, like the Lotus, like what you used. What else is different here? How do you like this still?
It sort of puts the emphasis on it, as though you're dealing with the time on it.
What's the difference of having a still versus not having a still? Isn't that a great pleasure? Isn't that still a great pleasure?
Yeah, it just makes me focus on the still as if it's,
okay.
You know, I don't know how to describe it.
Alexander?
Well, it seems like it's saying to learn is a great pleasure, and then also putting it into practice is a great pleasure. So it kind of makes you think about putting it into practice, like what emphasis.
What does it emphasize?
Putting it into practice. That does not take away from the pleasure. It's still a great pleasure.
What about the second one? To have a friend visit from somewhere far away, isn't that still a great joy? Yeah.
For me, it still makes it sound like the statement is qualified.
Mm-hmm. Right? Yes.
That is, though you may not have thought that this was a great pleasure or a great joy.
Yeah.
And so it seems to make the statements more problematic.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, that's how I would read it too. Isn't that still a great joy makes me think, I don't think it's a great joy anymore to have somebody visit from afar. But you're saying, well, there's somebody from afar, it's still a great joy, isn't it? So it gives this sort of connotation. Okay, let's look at the next one. Here we have, the master said, having studied, to then repeatedly apply what you have learned, is this not a source of pleasure? To have friends come from distant quarters, is this not a source of enjoyment? To go unacknowledged by others without harboring frustration, is this not the mark of an exemplary person? Okay, what's different here?
Study and learn are put in that first sentence.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we have both study and learn, first study, and then repeatedly apply what you have learned. The treatise is also different, right? Instead of gentleman, we have an exemplary person. Do you like that translation of Junzi? It's a little more contemporary. Okay, let's look at this one. To learn something and regularly practice it, is it not a joy? To have school fellows coming from distant states, is it not a pleasure? Not to resent when people do not know you, is it not like a gentleman? Okay, what's different here? What's good or bad?
Fellows.
Okay, how do you feel about the school fellows?
I don't like it.
You don't like it because?
Just, it's limited to friends or people you meet in school.
Mm-hmm.
And then, I don't know, I don't like how you can only have friends from school community.
Okay, almost everybody else has friends, right? This is probably the only one that treats the poem more as a peer, as a friend. But the use of the word schoolfellows makes it, makes the register a little bit different. It kind of doesn't fit with all the other stuff that he's talking about here. All the other language is a little more abstract, whereas the schoolfellows...
British boarding school, like.
It brings out that schema of the middle school environment, which you might not necessarily want over here.
So I was looking at Peng and Yu, mm-hmm. in Li Ji, mm-hmm. what's the English for Li Ji?
The Book of Rites.
The Book of Rites, that's mm-hmm. right. So you talk about the difference between Peng and Yu. You say Peng, Tong Men Yue Peng, Tong Zhi Yue Yu. So it kind of, if you say Tongmen Yue Peng, that is school fellow. You mm-hmm. you go to the same school, and mm-hmm. then that is a kind of a qualifier for Peng.
Okay.
And then if you have the same aspiration, that's Yu.
Okay. So you have the right reference, but the context or register doesn't quite sound right. Is there a better word? If you want it to express Tongmen.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Here is a little bit better, I think. Okay, look at this one, David H. Lee. Learning coupled with practice whenever possible, is it not joyful? Having a friend visit from afar, is it not delightful? Harboring no displeasure for not being recognized, is it not gentlemanly? What's different here?
For being not recognized.
For being not recognized, for not being recognized.
Well, it was that and then a couple of translations ago, it sounds like Victorian.
Okay. Now, notice how earlier the practice follows the learning or study. So these are two events, one is after the other, in most of your translations anyway. Over here, it's conflated, learning coupled with practice, as if it's at the same time. So you have this thing that's slightly different. And then for the shi, you have whenever possible, which is different from what the other translations have. How do you like the whenever possible? Okay, so that's it for this one. The second translation I was going to get you to do is this one here. I probably won't have time, if we want to finish at 4:15, we won't have time for everybody to come up and write your own translations. But let's walk through some of the main issues so that if you were to do it at home, you have an idea of what the options are. How many of you have seen this one before? Okay, good. So those of you that haven't seen this before, skim through it quickly. Is there anything important that you don't understand? 五十有而知于学，三十而立，四十而不惑，五十而知天命，六十而耳顺，七十而从心所欲，无欲矣。 Any big problems? Okay, my first question for you then is, how many sections would you divide it into? Okay, so six sections. Age 15 is one, 30 is another, 40, 50, 60, 70. It's talking about these different things happening at different stages in his life. Okay, in Chinese, the structure is more or less symmetrical. You have age, and then whatever happens then. Okay, 15, 30, 40, 50, 60. Okay, now when you're translating it into English, do you want to make it completely symmetrical like the Chinese? I guess if I were to give you two options, have it completely symmetrical or mix it up a bit, which would you prefer?
Symmetrical
would
be nice.
Symmetrical because?
That's just the way I like it.
Okay, anybody else? Does anybody want to mix it up?
It up.
Instead of saying, if I don't mix it up, at age 15 I was interested in study. At age 30 I was established. At age 40 I was never confused. At age 50 I understood my place in the world. That's it. So it's at this. If I mix it up, then I would say something like at age 15 I devoted myself to study, whereas when I reached 30 I did something else. By the time I was 40 I did this, and at age 50 I did something else. So same or different structure? Now there's an aesthetic difference here. In Chinese, in most of classical Chinese, you'll see that having this sort of strict parallelism is seen as a good thing. When you translate into English, however, it isn't necessarily a good thing. When you have too much of this, it reads more like a bullet list rather than like a paragraph. So, from an aesthetic point of view, you may think about mixing it up.
That's true.
The next thing to consider, the meanings of some of these things are not completely transparent. Okay, age 30, 三十 or li. What does the li mean? Literally, li means to stand up, right? Okay, and this is a conceptual metaphor. In most languages, there is a metaphorical meaning for standing up. In English, for example, you could say that an analog metaphor would be to stand up on your own 2 feet. But you have to, they don't always match up. What does it mean in English to stand up on your own 2 feet? To become independent. Does the Chinese here mean to become independent? Maybe, maybe not. Something to think about. Okay? 四十而不惑. What does the 不惑 mean? Literally, it means not confused. Not confused about what? And does this mean that he was confused before? Okay, something to think about. 五十而知天命. What does 天 mean? What is the mandate of heaven? Why is it important to do that, and why does it happen at age 50?
Well, if you don't respond to heaven's will.
Or another way to look at it is, why does it come before 40, after 40 and before 60? Is there a particular point to ordering these things? Does 学 have to come first, and then 立, and then 不惑, and then 知天命, and then 耳顺? If you can work out a logic where one has to be higher than the other, then you have a better transition, you have a better structure. Or shun, or means here, shun is to be smooth. What is to have a smooth ear?
Whatever people say, you accept it.
You accept what people,
whatever people
say,
you would accept.
So you're like a pushover?
Maybe that very pleasant everything, right?
Hmm?
Even the unpleasant things, you will accept it.
Okay. Is that a good thing or a bad thing?
Unpleasant? Not good.
I mean, if you accept everything that people say,
okay.
Is that a good thing?
I think so. Not arguing, not be unhappy.
But if somebody says, hey, you should go and take drugs, would you say, okay?
I think it means a less opinionated.
Less opinionated, okay? So you're more tolerant of different points of views. Okay, that could work. And then tissue. Is a little bit easier to understand. Now, let me get back to... Okay. Let's talk about the relationship between the age and then the event. Let's say 十有五 or 至于学. Now, is 十有五, we're going to interpret it as 15 for now. Is it at age 15, or is it by age 15, or is it from age 15? Is it this particular point? Is it everything before it? Or is it from this point onwards?
Around.
Around? Okay, at around age 15, I began to do this. At around age 30. Would you put around in your translation?
I don't.
If you put around, it would imply imprecision. And you don't have that in the original, right? Even if you were to say at age 15, it doesn't imply that it's exactly the day that you reach 15. You can still have that flexibility without using a reference. But, okay, something to think about, how you want to interpret the time frame. We don't have a lot. Oh, sorry, somebody was saying?
No.
Do we have time? Okay. So if we have time, let's look quickly through the existing translation. Okay, let's begin with this one. At 15, I set my mind to learning. At 30, I could stand on my own 2 feet, on my own 2 feet in parentheses. At 40, I was beyond doubt. At 50, I knew what heaven's decree held for me. At 60, I listened undisturbed. At 70, I could do whatever pleased me without fear of impropriety. Okay, really quickly, what do you like? What do you not like?
Fear of impropriety is a little bit away from the liberal meaning.
What's the little mean?
Well, I did not, Carpenter Square, I didn't go out of bounds.
Uh-huh.
That's what I was talking about.
That's cool.
Isn't that kind of like, interplay?
Yes, but it just seems once removed. I don't know what the linguistic term for that is, but
okay. It's a little more abstract.
You can make it literal, and then, so I think that's the meaning.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Good. Anything else? We talked about the standing on my 2 feet, how the metaphor in English could be different from the Chinese. What about at 40, I was beyond doubt? Are you happy with that? Or maybe people are just tired.
No, we're comparing it to Buddhism because the master explained it according to Buddhism.
Oh, okay. Tell me about it.
Probably very shy to say.
Okay.
There, those all have stages in one of their stages. They have many meanings.
Okay.
Being beyond doubt.
Hmm.
Being beyond doubt. Being able to act without. Knowing you're not
going to
make a mistake.
Mm-hmm. Hmm.
Brings you close to sage.
This is something that you also have in Buddhism?
The master explained a lot of Confucianism, and that was his take.
Okay.
He's a Buddhist take on that one.
That I did not know. I learned something new today.
What did the master say about Jitian Ni? Say what? What did the master say about Jitian Ni? What does that mean?
Well, I believe it means he knew what his destiny was by the time he was 50. He knew where he was going when he was 50. Probably something like that. You can look it up in Vada Bodhisu and see what the master's commentary was. Very enlightening. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, try this one. And to save time, I'm just going to skip straight to 60. At 60, my ear was the tune for her. How was that?
Because I have a hearing.
Okay. Lina, you like that? You like this? How would you interpret it? What does it mean here?
Well, I mean, maybe it's just because this is like the version that I read when I was first learning this.
Yes.
I like how it gets into traditional Chinese ideas about music being like integral to like harmony between the ruler and the population.
Oh,
and so
okay.
The idea is that like hearing is actually much more than just the physical sense of hearing, and that it requires a kind of attunement from the listener. So I like this idea of attunement.
That makes a lot of sense. And tell me your name again.
Tony.
Tony, okay. Without overstepping the line, would that be better for you?
No, it's a little ambiguous, but literal.
Okay. Now, look at 40. 四十而不惑. Oh, sorry, not 40, but 30. 三十而立, we have, at 30, I took my stand. This is quite different from standing on my 2 feet earlier. What does it mean here, took my stand? Is that what you would take it to mean? Lee.
He started sad kind of his value about life.
What?
He started sad his value about life.
Uh-huh.
And he said took my stand. It's like standpoint or
okay.
Standpoint.
You have a certain point of view and you're sticking to it. Right.
It's like
okay.
We are developing some standpoint based on his value at age 15.
Okay, good. And we're going to compare this with a few other interpretations of me in the following translations. Okay, this one is different in that instead of at, we have from. From 15, my heart and mind was set on learning. From 30, I took my stance. From 40, I was no longer doubtful. From 50, I realized the propensities of 10. From 60, my ear was attuned. From 70, I could give my heart and mind free rein without overstepping the boundaries. Okay, a few things I want to discuss here. First, how does the from sound to you? How do you like it?
It means like a whole time period after.
Yes. So from 15 all the way until my 70s, within this whole period, my heart and mind was set on learning. Do you like that better, or do you like it half better?
I like that.
Okay, you like it at because? It makes it more specific.
Yeah.
You can focus on a particular path at that time, and then when you get to this stage, you can focus on something else. Maybe that's the reason. Notice how Tian means. He doesn't translate the Tian as heaven. He simply uses the transliteration Tian. Okay, do you like that or not like that?
No.
Okay. That makes it opaque to somebody who doesn't know Chinese. But the reason for doing that is probably because the translator feels that heaven is different from the Chinese notion of tian. 智于学, the 智, he coins the term heart-and-mind. Do you like that? He wants to emphasize that this is not just the heart, but the heart and the mind, which makes it a little bit odd. But I guess from an academic point of view, it points to the reference a little bit better. Okay, let's see. Let's get this one out. Oh, no. What we wanted to look at here is how he breaks up the symmetry. At 15, I devoted myself to learning, and at 30, it stood firm. Okay, notice how he omitted the I in the second part, so that there's some more variation in rhythm. At 40, I had no doubts, and at 50, I understood the mandate of heaven. At 60, I listened in effortless accord, and at 70, I followed the mind's passing fancies, blah, blah, blah. Okay. How do you like the way he breaks up the symmetry?
Yeah,
Does it feel good, bad? No comments. Okay, let's look at another way we can break up the symmetry. Not this one, but later. We can look at this one too. This is by Ezra Pound, the poet. He said, instead of master said, at 15 I wanted to learn. At 30 I had a foundation. At 40, a certitude. At 15 knew the orders of heaven. At 60 was ready to listen to them. At 70 could follow my own heart's desire without overstepping the T-square.
A little bit dry.
A little bit dry because it's too mechanical. It is literally bullet points, right? Okay. He does try to break it up though by omitting the I in 40 and 50.
And then, we have the whole room running through a dictionary on T square.
Oh, okay. I was hoping you would know that. He was mentioning
it. Should be part of T
square. Okay.
No.
Yeah, this is an expression that we don't really use anymore.
Isn't it that L shaped thing? Okay.
I think we're exceeding our a lot of time, so let's do one more and then I'll finish. How does that sound? Okay. Okay, this one. At 15, said the master, I was fond of learning. At 30, I was established. At 40, I did not waver. At 50, I knew my sacred mission. At 60, I had a discerning ear. At 70, I could do what I would without going beyond what is right. First question for you. How many different interpretations of Li have we had so far?
Quite a few.
Okay. Give me some of them.
Established.
Okay.
Stood on two legs.
Stood on my own 2 feet. Okay.
Yeah,
I took my stand. So we have Li as being independent. We have Li as being established in society. We have Li as having my own position or viewpoint. Quite a few different interpretations of this metaphor. Okay, I better just stop here. I'll give the PowerPoint to the people here so that if you ever want to look at it, you can look at the other translations. Any questions before we finish? Okay, thank you.
Please stand up and find the right place to have a group photo.